Coming up on this Monday edition of Daybreak, the search for the missing AirAsia passenger jet resumes at first light after the plane carrying more than 160 people vanished from radar early Sunday. Italy's defense ministry says 192 of the nearly 500 people on the burning Norman Atlantic ferry in the Adriatic Sea have been rescued. Hundreds more remain trapped on board the stricken vessel. Plus, South Korea, the US and Japan will sign a trilateral intelligence sharing agreement on Monday to better cope with North Korea's increasing military threats. Daybreak begins now. Hello and thanks for joining us. To our viewers around the world, it's 6 a.m. on Monday, December 29th here in Seoul. I'm Mark Broome and you're tuned in to Daybreak. Our top story this morning, the search for the missing AirAsia flight that vanished with 162 people on board will resume in the coming hours. The Airbus flight QZ8501 took off from Indonesia for Singapore on Sunday but lost all contact with air traffic control during bad weather over the Java Sea. Connie Lee has the details.
Search operations are about to resume again at the break of light on Monday for any sign of missing AirAsia flight 8501. Indonesia's National Rescue Agency says seven ships and two helicopters will start operations in the area the plane is thought to have gone down. The search had to be called off on Sunday as night fell. At a news conference, AirAsia's chief executive said the plane had disappeared in bad weather, but said no conclusion can be made yet as to what happened.
We're very devastated by what's happened. It's unbelievable. But we do not know what's happened yet. The weather conditions were not good. But further than that, we don't really want to speculate anything more.
Air traffic control officials say the plane went missing a Sunday at 7:24 a.m. a local time after one of the pilots had requested to fly at a higher altitude to avoid storm clouds. The AirAsia flight was flying from the Indonesian city of Surabaya to Singapore when it went missing with 162 passengers on board. Of the people on board, most of them were Indonesian, with one British, Malaysian and Singaporean passenger and three people from Korea. According to Korea's foreign ministry, the Korean nationals are a couple in their 30s and their 11-month-old daughter. At a makeshift crisis center in Indonesia's Surabaya airport, more than 100 distraught relatives wait for news of their loved ones.
"We are very surprised and very sad. Our grandchild was going to Singapore for a holiday, but the accident happened."
AirAsia is a Malaysia-based budget airline and has not had a crash since it started operating in 2002. Connie Lee, Arirang News.
South Korea, the United States and Japan will sign a trilateral intelligence sharing agreement on this Monday to better cope with North Korea's increasing nuclear and missile threats. Seoul's defense ministry says, however, that South Korea will not share its most sensitive intelligence with Tokyo. A ministry official added that the same arrangement is in place between Washington and Tokyo. Under the pact, South Korea and Japan will not directly share military information either, but will use the U.S. as a go-between. The deal is expected to strengthen the trilateral security cooperation that has dried up in recent years due to territorial and historical disputes between South Korea and Japan. Russia's former ambassador to North Korea has been named as Moscow's new ambassador to South Korea. Russian news agency Interfax reports that Russian President Vladimir Putin has officially appointed that man there, Alexander Timonin, to serve as Russia's top envoy in Seoul. This, in fact, marks the first time a country has ever sent the same diplomat to be ambassador to South Korea after they had served in Pyongyang. Timonin, who replaces Konstantin Nukov, has experience fostering trilateral cooperation between the two Koreas and Russia. He also previously worked at the Russian embassy here in Seoul. South Korea's foreign ministry, which approved the appointment, said Timonin will likely start his new role next month. Japanese Vice Foreign Minister Akitaki Saiki will arrive in Seoul on this Monday for talks with his South Korean counterpart, Jo Tae-yong. Seoul's foreign ministry says the two diplomats will discuss pending issues such as Japan's wartime sexual enslavement of Korean women, and that's an issue that the two sides have been unable to resolve even after holding five rounds of high-level talks on the issue. South Korea wants a sincere apology from Japan and compensation for the victims. Japan, however, claims this issue was resolved through a bilateral treaty that was signed in 1965. The Japanese minister is also expected to express hopes for a summit between their two leaders in the near future. Well, it's time now for a look through the other global headlines we're following on this Monday morning here in Seoul. For that, we turn to Son Jung-in, who is standing by the news center for us. Good morning, Jung-in.
Good morning, Mark. Coast Guard officials are battling strong winds and waves as they struggle to rescue hundreds of people trapped on a burning ferry off the coast of Greece. The Italian Coast Guard said one passenger died after jumping off the ferry to try to escape the fire and that two other passengers were injured. The ferry was carrying more than 400 passengers and 56 crew members when the fire broke out early Sunday morning. The fire is believed to have started in the lower deck garage of the vessel. And according to the Italian Navy, which is leading the search and rescue operation, 192 people had been rescued, while well over 250 were still on board, mostly gathered on the upper deck, desperately waiting to be rescued. And over in Malaysia, where the country is suffering some of its worst flooding in decades, at least 10 people have been reported dead, while over 160,000 are estimated to have been displaced. The death toll comes as local media reports that the floods in the worst-affected state, Kelantan, are starting to recede, but many are feared to still be stranded. The government has allocated about $14 million to manage relief centers. Prime Minister Najib Razak, who is facing public criticism for his slow response, said extra funding would be made after visiting affected areas. Meanwhile, Thailand also declared disaster zones in eight of its southern provinces after floods killed at least 13 people there since mid-December. And it's been reported that more than 184,000 households were affected and nearly 8,000 people displaced in the country. The longest war in American history has finally come to an end. The U.S.-led coalition in Afghanistan formally ended its combat mission on Sunday, more than 13 years after launching airstrikes against Osama bin Laden's al-Qaeda and their Taliban protectors following the September 11th terror attacks in 2001. The U.S. and its NATO allies held a ceremony at their military headquarters in Kabul, with details withheld until the last moment for fear the insurgents might attempt an attack. And about 13,000 foreign troops, mostly Americans, will remain in the country under a new two-year mission named Resolute Support that will continue the coalition's training of Afghan security forces. And some 1,000 suspected Boko Haram fighters from Nigeria attacked five towns in northern Cameroon over the weekend and briefly occupied a military camp on Sunday before being removed by the Air Force. The exact number of casualties were not immediately known from both sides, but officials say at least 23 people are reportedly killed in the attack. Reuters reported that the heavily armed group attacked a military camp in Achigachia near the Nigerian border and that following an intense battle, the army abandoned the camp. It is the first time Cameroon has used the Air Force against Boko Haram.
We start before the sun rises to bring you the latest stories out of Korea. We also lead the way with important global coverage. Stay on the pulse of what is happening with Daybreak.
Now, the Korean government is pressing ahead with its deregulation drive as it looks to give the local economy a much-needed jolt in the arm. Officials from the public and private sectors met on Sunday to assess which regulations should stay and which should be scrapped. For more on what proved to be a pretty productive meeting, our Kim Ji-yeon reports.
With growing concerns over prolonged sluggish domestic demand and uncertainty stemming from the slowing global recovery, the Korean government decided to speed up its plans to strip away excessive red tape that many say is strangling the country's economic potential. Among the more than 150 rules economic organizations have suggested be scrapped, the government agreed on Sunday to fully remove or amend around three-quarters of them. Included was the expansion of the number of goods exempted from radiation tests and permission to store public records electronically. The meeting was also an opportunity for firms and private institutes to urge government agencies to review their regulatory policies. For example, providers of telecommunications services asked ministries to scrap regulations that require government approval before raising the price of mobile services. In response, the Science and ICT Ministry said it would come up with measures sometime early next year to address the inconvenience while fostering healthy competition among local providers. Proposals left for further review were mainly related to easing labor restrictions, including the removal of company quotas on hiring employees with disabilities. Kim Ji-yeon, Arirang News.
Now, Korea, one of the most wired countries in the world, is set to deploy a new mobile network service this year and keep rolling it out throughout next year. The country's largest telecommunications operators, SK Telecom and KT Corporation, say they are commercializing an ultra-high-speed three-band LTE-A service, and with it, users will be able to download a movie in less than 30 seconds. That's four times faster than the existing long-term evolution service many people have here in Korea. However, while the service is in its initial stages, it will only be available to people with a Samsung Galaxy Note 4 device and only in certain parts of the country where at least three audio frequencies are available. The operators say they are working on expanding availability throughout next year. The Korean government has confirmed that the nation will launch two indigenously developed satellites by the year 2020. The Ministry of Science, ICT and Future says the 500-kilogram satellites will be developed in conjunction with the Ministry of Land, Infrastructure and Transport, the Korea Aerospace Research Institute and a number of private industry partners. Now, medium-sized satellites are less expensive to develop than multi-purpose satellites, and there is growing international demand for them as well, particularly from developing countries. The government says it plans to pump over $200 million into the project, and this will hopefully help grow the nation's burgeoning space industry as well. Experts say the project will provide a great boost to the Korean space industry and also the commercialization of aerospace technology here in Korea. Now, it's December 29th, and that means it's the time of the year when people are getting ready to celebrate the coming of the new year in their own way, but not everyone has that privilege. Soldiers serving on the front lines cannot let down their guard, not even for a single second, no matter what time of the year it is. But a cutting-edge surveillance system implemented recently has lessened the burden a bit for them. Our Paulie reports.
As soon as irregular movements are detected near the central front line, every soldier in the unit is dispatched to their respective positions. Soldiers stand at the ready while receiving information on an enemy's location from the control room. This is a General Outpost, or GOP, scientific guard system which was implemented early this year. The cutting-edge cameras survey the area around the clock and sound an alarm when even the slightest movement near the ceasefire line is detected. The system has taken off some of the burden on soldiers and enabled the military to reinforce its operational capabilities.
Members in our unit are battling out bone-chilling cold weather while paying full attention to the GOP security operation.
As part of the Defense Ministry's drive to reform military culture, soldiers serving in general units can now keep in touch with family and friends online. They can also use their spare time for self-improvement activities like learning a foreign language or reading books. The military plans to strengthen the GOP Scientific Guard system within all frontline units next year, so they are fully prepared for a possible enemy provocation while keeping the nation safe. Paul Yi, Arirang News.
Now, staying up there near the border, and local researchers recently conducted an ecosystem analysis for the first time in the demilitarized zone, but actually not on land, a little bit off Korea's east coast. And it was there that they found over 150 species, including several endangered ones. Kim Hyun-bin reports.
In the no-man's zone of Korea's East Sea are numerous animals' footprints, their owners, sea otters that are on the brink of extinction. Nearby, on rocky islands, are cormorants resting in harmony with nature. They're also on the endangered list. Underwater, there are even more rare species and plants, including the philospatics, aquaticus. Neon damselfish, among other fish, also roam through the waters. In the past, it was impossible for researchers to take samples in the demilitarized zone, as there are lost mines hidden in numerous areas. But with the help of Korea's Ministry of National Defense, it became all possible for researchers to conduct an ecosystem analysis in the region. A total of 151 marine life were discovered, including seven on the endangered species list. The Ministry of Maritime Affairs and Fisheries says they will continue their search to discover new species, as well as to preserve the ones that are endangered. Kim Hyun-bin, Arirang News.
Now, SK Hynix is one of the key movers and shakers in the world's highly lucrative memory chip industry. But just a decade ago, it was a very different story, with the company teetering on the brink of bankruptcy with little hope of survival. For this week's Industry Insider, Hwang Ji-ae tells us about one of the most remarkable turnarounds in Korea's business history.
For three straight quarters this year, SK Hynix reported over 1 trillion won, or roughly 900 million U.S. dollars, in operating profit. In the third quarter, it earned $30 for every $100 of sales, meaning it was more profitable than Apple in terms of operating profit margin. So what's driving the company's robust growth recently? Take a look.
The memory chip industry is all about adding a ton of a memory storage onto a tiny semiconductor. That includes DRAM chips for computers and flash chips used in smartphones and digital cameras. So, the name of the game is miniaturization technology and an efficient manufacturing process. And SK Hynix, the world's second largest chip maker, excels in reducing production costs.
Basically, DRAM is a kind of commodity. So just to be a low-cost producer is the most important thing. Basically, during the last, like, around 30 years, SK Hynix remained as a low-cost producer.
Industry experts say the company's survival instinct has led to engineering innovations that pushed production costs down.
When SK Hynix was going through hard times in the past, it wasn't able to invest in facilities, so it had to operate its factories with very little money. But it was back then when the company accumulated its know-how. So in terms of production efficiency, it has become the number one.
Established in 1983 as Hyundai Electronics, the company was pushed to the brink of collapse both in the wake of the 1997 Asian financial crisis and in the 2008 global financial crisis. The debt-laden company also suffered from years of a cutthroat game of slashing prices played out by more than 20 memory chip makers. In 2001, its creditors forced it into a debt workout program. The seemingly never-ending story of financial trouble ended when SK Group, one of Korea's three largest conglomerates, took it over in 2012 and renamed it SK Hynix. With the help of its new deep-pocketed parent, the company could aggressively invest in the latest production facilities as well as research, while the rest of the industry players were cutting back. Now the business environment for SK Hynix seems positive, with Samsung Electronics and Micron Technology of the U.S. remaining as the company's only rivals. The demand for memory chips is also growing thanks to the ever-evolving smartphone. Of course, a peaceful cohabitation by the three powers could end if the industry leader Samsung aggressively increases its market share or if newcomers decide to pour in money to enter the market. For the foreseeable future, however, SK Hynix is poised to enjoy profits. Hwang Ji-hye, Arirang News.
And a good Monday morning to you all as we kick things off with the 2015 Asian Cup, which is set to kick off on January 9th in Australia. And as for the Korean national football team arrived in Sydney, Australia on Saturday, there's a lot of work to be done for manager Uli Stoike, including selecting his captain. That was by Swansea City midfielder Ki Sung-yong being named the captain during the first few months under manager Uli Stoike. That's not the case this time during the Asian Cup, as the 60-year-old manager has yet to select his captain in Australia. Of the three candidates at the moment are Koo Ja-char, the captain during the 2014 Brazil World Cup, Lee Chung-young, who has held his captain's armband before, and Ki Sung-young, who might continue his position as Stoike's captain. And now moving over to golf this time, where Golf Week listed their top 10 LPGA stories of the year, and topping the list, well, Korean-American Michelle Wee. Now, despite being considered one of the biggest disappointments in women's golf at one point, Korean-American Michelle Wee had a breakout year in 2014 as she won the 2014 U.S. Women's Open. Her dramatic victory was listed as the top story of the year in Golf Week. Now, meanwhile, 17-year-old Lydia Ko's incredible rookie season was listed at number 3, while Christina Kim's dramatic win at the Lorena Ochoa Invitational was listed at number 4. And now from women's golf to men's golf in the PGA, where CBS Sports listed the top 5 young golfers who could shake up this sport in 2015. And at number 3, 23-year-old Noh Seung-yeol. Now, the 23-year-old who won the Zurich Classic in April and became the youngest Korean to win a PGA title was listed at number 3 as the article praises swings. Now, Noh Seung-yeol, who has one of the prettiest golf swings in the sport, struggled a bit after his win in April, but at the young age of 23, he has plenty of room for improvements in the future. Meanwhile, at number 1 in the list was another 23-year-old in Tommy Fleetwood, an Englishman who had 6 top 5 finishes in the European Tour. And now finishing things off, if there's one athlete who especially enjoyed this past year, it's Victor Ahn, a.k.a. Ahn Hyun-soo. And over the weekend, Eurosport named him Russia's Athlete of the Year. Now, with Eurosport naming the top athletes of each European nations, 29-year-old Victor Ahn was named Russia's Athlete of the Year after winning 3 gold medals at the Sochi Winter Games. Despite short track not being considered a popular sport in Russia before, the success of Ahn led to a huge rise in popularity as many young kids in the nation are showing interest in the sport. And that's going to wrap it up for me. This has been SJ. Have a great rest of the day and see you guys again for your sports needs.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Michelle Park here with the latest weather forecast. It looks like we're starting our week with cloudy conditions nationwide. We will also see high levels of fine dust particles from China that is being blown over by the winds coming from the west. However, we are hoping this will be relieved by the rain we are expected today. The rain will be mainly focused over in the west side of the peninsula as well as on Jeju Island. Along with that, we can expect relatively mild conditions across the nation with highs ranging from 7 to 11 degrees Celsius, which is higher than the seasonal average. And now to our readings for today. Seoul will peak up to 7 this afternoon. Meanwhile, the southern cities such as Gwangju and Busan will be a bit higher at 9 and 11 degrees. And to other regions such as Jeju Island peaks up to 10, Dokdo hits 8, while Mount Geumgang is below freezing at negative 4 degrees. Well, that's all for now. Michelle Park, and have a wonderful day.
Well, thank you very much, Michelle, for the weather there. And that's going to do it from us for now. Korea Today is coming up at the top of the hour, 7 a.m. Korea time. Have a great day. Goodbye.